Howdy everybody, it's Glenn with the Cactus Atlas, and today we're going to be exploring the Pima Air and Space Museum in Tucson, Arizona. All right, we have not even entered and paid admission yet, and we were greeted by this. That's already a good sign of things to come, I think. Well, isn't that pretty cool? That's actually one of the booster rockets for the space shuttle. Something that I was very familiar with in my childhood. A child of the 1980s, that is. It's enormous. Oh, I've just entered here and I'm already overwhelmed. And this is just the tip of the iceberg. You got other buildings, you got things outside. Ooh, this is gonna take a long time, I think, in a good way. We're standing underneath, I think, a replica of the Wright Brothers plane from their first winged flight. Wow, and this next thing is the gunner's compartment for a B-52D. That is cool. Just one part of the plane. Wonder if we could see back here. Oh, look at this. Well, as mentioned, this is my very first visit here. In the almost 20 years I've lived in Arizona, I've never visited this and I've always wanted to. Just one of those weird things that I just haven't made it out to, and I'm finally here. And I just don't know what to do. Oh wow, look at that. Isn't that a little bit fancy in there? If we can get you in there to see, you got like zebra print on the seats back there. That looks comfy. All right, I have way underestimated this place. I should have plenty of time to see just about everything because I think they recommend about 3 to 4 hours to spend here. And once again, we haven't even gone outside yet. So this is just the very beginning. And like, I don't know where to stop. I mean, there's just stuff everywhere. You got stuff on the ceilings, stuff parked everywhere, planes from all different ages. There's one of the Blue Angels jets right here in the first hangar. Lieutenant Smokey Tolbert. Wow, these things look like my old G.I. Joe toys from the 1980s. I swear to God. This thing's pretty cool. Look at that. You got war machines, you got like experimental aircraft. This section seems to be all military related, whereas the section we entered through seemed to be more commercial aircraft, I'm guessing. You got not even just planes, but you've got, I assume that's some kind of anti-aircraft gun. So we have two things here. You have, I believe, one of like the first stealth fighters or bombers. I think that's the SR-71. But right here in front of me is actually, it kind of blends in with it. That's actually a drone, an unmanned aircraft, up close and personal. So I didn't really know that. This SR-71 Blackbird was actually the second one ever built that's on display here now. And this thing took flight, I think, for the first time in 1965. I thought it was something from like the 1980s. Boy, am I wrong. I remember as a kid, I used to love to just draw jets and make paper airplane jets and all sorts of stuff. And I remember seeing this when I was a kid, and I was obsessed with this aircraft, the SR-71. It looks like some kind of alien technology, doesn't it? I assume this is a rendition of what it would be like to be a pilot in this aircraft, one of the two people that would fly this. So I think this is showing you what's in the nose of the SR-71. It could house different things like radar equipment, and I think that's what this is. That's really cool to see like what is inside. I have never seen all these crazy kind of planes before. I just had no idea. Like, have you ever seen anything quite like this before? Is that real? I think these are all seaplanes, so you can kind of see it's got like a floatable bottom, I assume. And some pontoons here on the side. And this too, I think, is some kind of seaplane. I still haven't seen a sign to say exactly what it is, but it's gigantic. Look at the compartment where the wheel goes. It's huge. And look at this teeny little plane here. This red and white one. It's underneath the whole wing of this gigantor seaplane. I love seeing these small planes like this that are just underneath the wing. Here's another one. I'm not quite sure if you're allowed to sit in that. Not that I could really fit in it with my 6'2" large stature, but that's pretty neat, whatever it is. Well, I'm gonna move outside really quick to see back here, because I think there's a whole bunch more stuff out there, but I still might want to come back in here to check out more stuff later because I kind of blew through it. Oh my gosh, where does one even begin? This is a strange day. I'm starting to have memories that I forgot about from my childhood rushing back at me. I just loved fighter jets when I was a kid. I remember seeing Top Gun, the famous movie Top Gun, as a kid, and watched it so many times. And that's what I always said I wanted to be when I grew up, was like a naval aviator. That was my dream as a child, and that didn't happen. Seeing all this stuff makes me remember how I used to like to draw aircraft like this, all of my G.I. Joe toys, all the jets, and I think I even built model planes, if I remember correctly, here and there. But yeah, this is just something cool. I used to know like a lot of the model names of these jets and stuff, and I've long since forgotten. I'm really rusty, but maybe if I hang out here for a little while, it'll all rush back. Something about this one is calling my name. I don't know. Let's see if we can find out when this was from. Let's take a guess. I'm gonna guess 1950s. I wasn't too far off, I guess. This is a Martin 404 Civil Transport, 1950 to 1986. I just like the retro colors, the stripes on there for some reason. Oh, I thought this looked kind of familiar. This is the Lockheed 49. I think this is one of the Constellation aircraft. Not the exact one that crashed in Prescott, Arizona, where they have like a memorial today in the 1950s. If I remember correctly, I think this plane, I don't know if it was this plane or one like it, that transported President Eisenhower and other generals from that time frame in the 40s and 50s. But if I'm not mistaken, that might be close to what the I think it was a Lockheed 121G that crashed in Prescott in the 1950s. And I've looked at pictures of that, and it has the same kind of tail. Pretty large aircraft like that. So that's cool, actually. Well, what do you know here? This is Air Force One, or one of the Air Force Ones that was in operation 1961 to 1965. And both Presidents Kennedy and Johnson flew in this very plane. It makes it cooler when you can tie something like this to actual presidents of the United States, and Kennedy for that matter. And it looks like right next to this version of Air Force One, I'm going to assume that's another version of Air Force One. It looks like a more modern version. It's not propeller driven like the one behind me. You can hear it kind of creaking in the wind. So if I didn't know in advance before I came here what this was and why it looks like that, I'd be like, what the heck? But now that I see it with my own eyes and not like in a photo, I am like, what the heck? It is much larger than what the picture made it seem. This is called a Super Guppy. It's a cargo plane. And when I saw it online, I was like, what the heck? But basically what this thing was made for was for transporting really light but bulky items. So you can see it's got that really large fuselage. But I just have a hard time imagining this thing in flight. How the heck? I've never seen anything quite like that. One thing I noticed on this Super Guppy is if you're standing under here, standing next to the plane, you could see this whole side bulges out. It's almost like a Zeppelin kind of shape, if you start to think about it. And this is a NASA aircraft. Wait a second, is this the thing that flew the space shuttle maybe? Remember where there's a plane that I think it transported the space shuttle? Let's go look at this and see, because that's odd. Or is this a vomit comet? I'm not too bad here. I don't want to make you think that I know a lot about planes, because I really don't. It was a guess. But this is a vomit comet. It's a Boeing KC-135A. So for those of you that don't know, why is it called the vomit comet? That sounds kind of odd. It does have to do with puking. This is one of those planes that they would train, I think, astronauts for like zero-G training, and I think it takes... Basically, I think what the plane does is it just goes like up in like arcs like that. So it creates moments of weightlessness. I think pretty long periods of weightlessness, relatively speaking. And you can actually see it. There's a movie, what was it? They filmed Apollo 13, that's what it was. In the movie Apollo 13, I don't know if it was like the same model, but I think the actors actually flew in a vomit comet. You'll see a scene where one of the actors throws up when they were filming it. And they did it in something like this, I think. These are scary looking machines. These look like death machines to me. Look at that, it's got like a gun turret in the front. This is a Mi-24D Hind. Still in use today. I think this is a Russian helicopter, the Hind. Isn't this the same helicopter that was in Rambo 3? The one where they go to Afghanistan? I wanna say it was a type of Hind. This back corner, I have no idea what we're looking at, but it's cool. It's a really funky design, and it's made of bricks. How can they get that to fly? So this is the Air and Space hangar, and I talked to the gentleman up there. There's actually a few really notable things in here to point out. I'm really glad I came in here because this would be easy to miss. It's kind of tucked away in the back corner. If you see that US Air Force plane back there, that's supposedly the first aircraft in space. It was flown up on a B-52, and then it launched out in the air up into space and kind of came back down. And the gentleman said, you know, if you think about it, it's not too far from how the space shuttle actually operated. He also said, right here is a trainer they used for the space shuttle. All of the astronauts that flew shuttles, I think, trained in these simulators. Here's another look at the other side of that trainer, the shuttle trainer. It looks very space shuttle-like, doesn't it, from this perspective? Or like an alien aircraft. And this here, I think, is an Apollo space capsule. I think this might also have been a trainer. I don't know if this is one that actually went into outer space, but nonetheless, really cool. He mentioned that the actual thing would have had the heat shield on the back, so they've removed that so we can actually take a peek in here, see what it would have been like being in this capsule. I mean, it's actually more spacious. I'm not saying it's spacious by any means, but it's more spacious than I would have thought. I think I could actually sit comfortably in there if I wanted to. One other thing that's really cool to see in person is a Predator drone, which he also pointed out is in here, suspended right here. It's crazy that you think of a drone being something like that, like the size of like an aircraft. How freaky is that? That was cool, the aerospace gallery. Definitely don't forget to poke your head in that place. That's awesome. All right, it's time to go check this out. The B-17 Flying Fortress. This is one of the things that I read about and saw pictures of that I'm really excited to check out in here. So it's time to go check it out. You can kind of look inside this thing. Wow, how would you like to be in that? The B-17 bomber. It's a very impressive aircraft. All those different like gunner turrets. You got one in the tail, on the top, on the bottom. So far, this is one of the highlights of the day for me. Just seeing all those gun turrets and stuff and just trying to put myself into the mind of someone on a mission, like perhaps flying on a bombing mission to Berlin or something like that. I've noticed a couple times now when you can get close to these aircraft, like when I poke my head up into the cockpit, it smells like jet fuel or some kind of, you know, smell. Like you would smell even like at a regular airport today. I wonder if that's remnants of jet fuel that I smell. It's hard to describe it. It does smell like a fuel or like a burnt smell. So if anybody can confirm that's what it is, let me know. I'm assuming, I don't know if this thing still flies or not. I should ask. That was even better than I thought it was going to be. I didn't realize you can actually peek into the cockpit. Look at those 500-pound bombs. By the way, they were 500-pound bombs, according to the guy in there. All right, Hangar 3. Let's go check you out now. Oh, wow. Look at this one. That almost looks like another flying fortress. Some kind of bomber, I assume. So this is a bomber. It's a B-24J. I think this was originally sent over to the British Royal Air Force in World War II. And somehow it ended up in India. And this was donated by India to the museum. This is not the turret that I would want to be in. It's kind of hard to see with the reflections, but there's like a mannequin in there and he's kind of like on his back with his feet up. like here, facing forward in this gun turret underneath the plane. I imagine that had to be the most frightening job. Yeah, the World War II era planes don't disappoint here. They have quite a few in these hangars, and they even had a Nazi plane in there, which is really interesting to see. I don't think I've ever seen one before. And here we have the B-29. Betty. Smell that same smell in this plane that I smelled earlier. It's pretty frightening. I don't see any bombs in here, but this is any indication of how large of bombs they could have put in here. I don't even want to know what they were capable of. It's kind of an odd name for a plane like this, but okay. This is an actual aircraft that was captured by the United States in the 1940s, and it was shipped back to the US so we could learn about it, but there really wasn't too much to learn, they said. And now it lives in a museum. That's an actual Japanese fighter plane from World War II. I mean, probably needless to say, if you're into World War II era aircraft, you are out west. I mean, this is a fantastic place to see that. Okay, so a time check. I've been here about 3.5 hours, and I can tell you I'm not done yet. And I can also tell you that areas that I have completed for the day, I didn't by any means stop and look at every single plane, just to give you an idea of how much ground there is to cover here. My favorite things though are inside the hangar so far, I would say today. I mean, there's awesome stuff outside, but the World War II era planes, and the fact that you can get under them, look into the bombing bays, climb into some of the cockpits to take a peek, like on the B-17 Flying Fortress. So neat. And we have yet another hangar now to explore. I think this is the last one. I don't think we missed any. I have to double check. But you have a bunch of other what look to be World War II era aircraft in here. So this hangar is a really nice vantage point. We can get up above the planes here. Not every hangar has this. I wish they did, because you can get a really nice view. A much better view from up here, in my opinion. It's like here we have a transport plane that you can actually go inside. I'm assuming this is where guys would parachute out of this, like you would see in movies. Oh, man, I gotta crouch down in here a little bit. It's a little bit tight quarters here. Here we get a really good look at the cockpit. That is neat. This is a Lockheed Lodestar is the name of this aircraft. Imagine sitting here, I guess, waiting to be told to, I assume, parachute out into enemy territory. Well, your plane's probably being shot at and rough. Gives me the willies. Okay, so I believe I've been in all 5 hangars now. That was 3, 4, and 5 over there. And then you had the B-17 Flying Fortress and the aerospace hangar. I think that's all of them. I'm not even sure what advice to give you if you want to come visit this. My advice is come visit it. How much time do you need? I tried to fit this into a half day, and I think as the website says, I was able to go to every hangar as far as I know. I think I walked through all of the grounds. I did not stop in front of each and every plane though. I mean, I only looked at the ones that really interested me. If I wanted to stop and see everything, I don't even think a full day could do it here if you want to read every exhibit. So my best advice is go to their webpage, which we'll put a link to that down below in the description. And they have a list of all the aircraft they have on display here. So you can kind of peruse that, figure out what you want to see, and then prioritize that, like I did today, kind of. I knew what the cool stuff was that I wanted to see, but everything ended up being cool. It's really hard to pick and choose here. All right, well, that's gonna do it, folks. Pima Air and Space Museum in Tucson, Arizona. This place was amazing. I can't believe I waited almost 20 years to come check this place out, and I do hope you get a chance to see it one day yourself. See you next week.